Okay, am I on? Can you hear me out there? I want to see Marines in the back. Give me a thumbs up if you can hear me. Roger, thank you. Okay, please, gentlemen, take your seats. Thank you. Reminds me of my days in the basic school when we wouldn't make a move unless somebody told us to take our seats. First of all, my name is Frank Kelley, and I am extraordinarily proud to be able to be the chair for this panel, focusing on unmanned systems, but more importantly, focusing on the human-machine team. Okay, I don't think that you're going to find another panel in Sierra and Space that is going to talk about human-machine teaming, an incredibly important element to what we see as our future in unmanned systems. So one thing that I want to tell you right now, here's the good news. We want you to use your devices, okay? You are not going to hear me say turn them off, because you never do anyway, right? Nobody ever does. What I want you to do is I want you to take a look at this new app. Yes, we're leading with our faces here today, okay? I want you to take a look at this app, and we're going to experiment a little bit today. The folks at Sierra and Space have asked us to utilize this app to where if you feel like you can't get to a microphone fast enough or you would like to remain anonymous, we're going to use this app to help us ask some questions. And we've got some folks, some great folks that are going to be queuing up the questions for us. And I really, again, I can't say enough about the folks here at Sierra and Space. They actually came to us and asked us if we would like to participate. We seized the opportunity because in our particular shop for the Assistant Secretary of the Navy for Research, Development, and Acquisition, a new DASN, a new Deputy Assistant Secretary of the Navy for Unmanned Systems, to be able to participate this early in the evolution of our office is unique. And we are really proud to participate. I've got a couple of people here, and I know that everybody else is probably going to introduce their folks, but they're right here in the front. We've got Commander Carol Lapointe, who's my chief of staff, Dorothy Engelhart, who helps run programs. We've got my futures guy here, a guy by the name of Chris Del Mastro, and Andy Van Syok, way in the back. Andy probably didn't get to sleep at all last night because he is absolutely, anxiety-ridden, that he wants to make sure that this thing gets pulled off, okay. And I can see some other folks in the audience, by the way, that have really supported us. And really good to see you out there, Greg. Thanks for being here. I am going to assume that you are here because you have an interest in unmanned systems, okay. Not that you didn't have anything better to do with your time. We need you to engage. We want you to participate. And your questions, quite frankly, are going to help us form where we go in the next couple of months as we build our unmanned future for the Navy. So we've got a distinguished panel. Got a distinguished panel today, and I'm actually going to start at the end with Colonel Jenkins. One of the things that you'll know about Colonel Jenkins, one thing that we really pride when we talk about Marines, is you got a complete MAGTF officer there. Colonel Jenkins is a 1990 graduate of Cornell University, and I only know of one other Marine that is a graduate of Cornell University, and that is our Assistant Commandant, General John Paxton. He is the smartest man I know. So, Jenks, up to you to prove me wrong about that if you want. He's a WTI, a weapons tactics instructor. We send our best and brightest to WTI. He's got several MU deployments with 2-2 and 2-4, served several tours in the Med. He's been an aide, which is no easy task, let me tell you that. He's been a WTI instructor. He was a CO of HMLA 269 and also MAG 29. He's been to AWS and also the Army War College. He's got a master's in international relations, and he also went to the Army War College. Currently, he is the Director of Science and Technology at the Marine Corps Warfighting Lab. And Jinx, I'm really happy that you're here. Thanks for being here today. From the Coast Guard, our sister sea service, we have Admiral Nadeau. He is the Assistant Commandant for capabilities. No small job, I'm sure, especially for a one-star. He's from Maine, and he's a 1989 graduate of the Coast Guard Academy. He has had tours as the Chief of Inspection, the Senior Investigating Officer, the CO of the Safety and Maintenance Chief, the Office of Design and Engineering and Standards, and he's been the Head of Delegation at the International Maritime Organization. So to me, that sounds like you are the face of the United States Coast Guard globally, which is, again, no small task. And it's no surprise that he was the United States Coast Guardsman Engineer of the Year in 1998. It's really a pleasure to have you here
Thanks, sir.
General Vinny Coglianese, okay? And if there's anybody here that we can say is sort of like the godfather of the panel, it could be General Coglianese, okay? He is the Assistant Deputy Commandant at INL, working for Lieutenant General Dana. He is a warrior and a complete MAGTAF officer as well. He hails from New Jersey. He's a 1983 graduate of Indiana University and also a graduate of probably one of the most famous and challenging basic school classes that we've ever had. That was Gulf Company 783. A pleasure to have you here as well, sir. He's a Motor T officer, served time with the wing as an engineer. He was an OPSO during Desert Shield, Desert Storm, served in Operation Enduring Freedom, Operation Iraqi Freedom. He was the commander of CSSD 78, a service support group for MU, 224 MU, and also the commander of CLR 27. There's a number of firsts that General Coglianese has remarkably stood up for our Marine Corps, and they all involve surrounding SOCOM, and a remarkable feat to be the first Marine and also the first Marine J4 as well. So, sir, thank you for being here as well. Admiral Bob Girrier. I work closely with Admiral Girrier. He has suggested that I call him Bob. I just can't do that. You are Admiral Girrier to me. We work closely with his shop, and he's got a number of his folks. As a matter of fact, when I look at this front row right here, with the exception of Steve Kwan, our app guy over here, it is DAS and Unmanned and N99, and to be quite honest, sir, that is not surprising to me at all. He's a 1983 graduate of the United States Naval Academy with merit. He's got a master's in international affairs, a master's in marine affairs, and a master's in public admin from the Monroe School of the Kennedy School of Government. And he specialized in negotiations and conflict resolution. And I can think of nobody more qualified to spend time in the Pentagon at this time, sir, than you. I didn't know that about you before. And now it has all become so much clearer to me that I know that you have those special skills. His commands are absolutely incredible. Commander of three strike groups and Carrier Strike Group 7, the Ronald Reagan Strike Group, and also a Nimitz Strike Group, Carrier Strike Group 11. Absolutely great to have you here as well. You're also the author of several books, and you can tell that this is a man who values leadership and values leadership in teaching our young naval officers on how to do their tasks. So that's a responsibility that everybody wished they could take on, but few have actually done it. Our last guest is Dr. Peter Singer, and he's a strategist and senior fellow at the New American Foundation. Do a Google search if you want on Dr. Singer, and you will find out if there's a list of 100 great thinkers in America today, Dr. Singer is on that. The Smithsonian Institute National Portrait Gallery, 100 leading innovators. Defense News is one of the most 100 most influential people in defense, and Defense News top 100 global thinkers. Wall Street, the Wall Street Journal, which I'm sure many of you read, states that Dr. Singer is the premier futurist. Absolutely remarkable in terms of the way that Dr. Singer thinks and the way that he compels us to be thinking as well. But the one thing that I do want to thank you, sir, and that's the time that you take to appear with what is primarily a military panel, the time that you've taken to appear down at smaller venues, down at Quantico, even the work that you've done for us at the Pentagon. Hopefully not over the top, but you know, there's many ways to be a patriot, and the way that you make us think, I think, is a call to patriotism. So, ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to tell you right now that you've got a remarkable panel. Please take advantage of the panel and ask some challenging questions. So, what I'm going to do is I'm going to tee up. This is the order that we're going to go in, but I'm going to tee up some slides for you, and I'm going to sit down because it's not fair if I stand up. But it was about a year ago that the Secretary of the Navy, at this particular conference at Sea Air and Space, decided that he was going to create two new organizations within the Department of the Navy, and it was a new Deputy Assistant Secretary of the Navy, and that's our job, the one that I'm in, that I'm quite proud to be in charge of up in the Pentagon on the Secretary of the Navy staff, but also N99, an OPNAV resource sponsor. And when you have a resource sponsor, that means that you as a department are very serious about what you're about to do, and that's what Admiral Girrier is doing. The things that are really, really important about that, though, are the fact that the Secretary told us to use our imaginations. And you don't necessarily get that, get permission from your highest leadership to use your imagination. And I will say that both new organizations and with our with the people that we work with and for within the deputy within the Secretariat of the Navy and our high nines on the resource sponsor side of the house are all doing that a great job. Now my boss is Mr. Sean Stackley. Mr. Stackley is incredibly involved. We were given some tasks in terms of developing a roadmap, developing goals for the department in terms of where we were going to go with our unmanned systems, and Mr. Stackley is deeply engaged in all phases of that tasking. Next. Okay. Some of the themes that you're going to hear today, but these are the themes that we've had a chance to talk about in our office and when we get a chance to speak. We've emphasized this human-machine teaming, and that's obviously the thrust of what we're going to be talking about today. It's not a one-for-one replacement. We had a chance to do some media events, and one of the things we wanted to emphasize to the media is that we are not trying to replace Marines and sailors with unmanned systems. That is not the goal. We need to optimize our use of unmanned systems and think about autonomy as well when you think about optimizing our use. To what degree are we going to allow these systems to be fully autonomous or remotely operated by Marines and sailors? And one other thing that I'd like you to think about is we need to get out of this paradigm that of domain, of that only aviators can talk about unmanned aviation systems, and that only submariners can talk about things that dwell underneath the water. The biggest thing that we like to emphasize is that unmanned systems are going to fundamentally change the way the Department of the Navy operates in the future. And you could probably provide some examples of where it already has. I love this picture, but our future, the future that we envision, is where Marines and sailors are working side by side with unmanned systems. And I think Jinx has some footage a little bit later on that will go into a little bit more detail on that. Just going more on the not a one-for-one replacement. We're not trying to take those things, those missions that we used to do with Marines and sailors, and now going to just do those things with unmanned systems. We're going to open up our eyes and think about new ways, new missions, new ways to operate. Next. Some of those new ways are going to be in swarms, where we can utilize the elements of warfighting like mass and surprise with considerably larger numbers than we would ever thought about previously. And that would be, I'm not talking about tens of things, I'm talking about thousands of things being able to mass and surprise. Also being able to fight in areas where we may not have fought in the past, underground, maybe on the surface, as part of the surface. We really need to think completely differently about the way we've waged war and where we've waged it before. Next. I like this slide. This is just one way to think about the domains. It's not about the sky and the surface. It's not about a jungle environment. It's not about an Arctic environment. It's about the new missions and utilizing those environments to maximize the capability that we're going to have with unmanned systems in the future. Next. Throughout our history, we've had a variety of ways to modify and modernize our warfare, and this just shows a progression of where we are today. It's a cultural issue. And even just mentioning that it's a cultural issue is something that's tough for everybody in our department. It's a human thing, okay, to challenge our culture. But this is one of the things that we have got to realize that has to be done. We do need to change the culture. Next. 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 Thank you. Hey, I'll tell you what. You're going to hear this today, too. Trust is a critical element of what we do. It's trust in the systems. It's trust in the people that are going to develop these systems. It's trust in the people that are going to actually operate these systems. But almost more importantly, it's trust in the system itself. And someday, we might be able to replace that particular image of a Marine and the dog with an automated system. We need to be prepared for what these relationships, these warfighting relationships, these relationships between Marines and sailors and the machines that they're going to fight with and alongside are going to go. Okay. Now, I've already introduced all our panel members. I'm not going to introduce them again. Colonel Jenkins, so typically when I'm in a position like you, Jinx, right now, and I'm the junior guy on the board, and we've emphasized that quite a bit, as I'm sure has become conspicuously clear, okay? My response to that is first to fight, and in your case, first to brief. So, Jinx, take it away.
Thanks, sir. First of all, into the Navy League, thanks for having me. I really appreciate the opportunity today. As I was thinking about this, I really focused on the word evolution. And to me, evolution implies change and hopefully progress. And so with that in mind, I wanted to start with some very recent past of what we've been looking at the lab, but really focus more on where we think we're going with respect to unmanned systems and with respect to autonomy. So as an opening gambit, this is what we see as a state of unmanned systems today. As Daz and Kelley said, they're not a one-for-one replacement, but unfortunately, by and large, they require an operator to constantly manage the system and run the system, and also be ready to assume control of the system or of the task at any time. And so you've got a one-to-one ratio, and they're really not multiplying force at this point. They are creating standoff, they're creating force protection for those operators. But at the end of the day, what we found is when the bullets start flying, the Marine either becomes so absorbed in driving the robot that he loses SA to what's happening around him, or he drops the controller and becomes a rifleman again. And so we want to move past that. Next slide. Expeditionary Force 21 is the operating concept that the Marine Corps involves, and what we really see this supporting and where we need unmanned systems to go is systems that are taskable in the same manner, in the same way that a squad leader, a company commander would task humans that work for him or are in support of him. They need to be functional and sustainable in a distributed manner, and then they need to really, again, work as a team and be functional in a dense urban environment, which is probably the most challenging environment for these things, especially when we talk access to GPS signals and things like that. So at the lab, we've done a couple of things to try and start moving away from that remotely operated vehicle and towards autonomous systems that will accomplish tasks as part of a team with people. So next slide. The first one we're talking about is SPOT. You see that earlier. What this is basically no more than pre-programmed responses. So the robot knows, go into the building, take a look around, report back, and then squat and hold. Great if nothing unexpected happens, but we know in war that's likely not to be the case. We can expand that in time and space with something like GUS. So a vehicle that I can program with a route that I can program to go to certain points along a route and onload and offload supplies or Marines. More autonomous, but again, it doesn't handle a changing situation well, and it needs to be caught at either end. So our ultimate goal is something like this, a multi-unmanned system platform that allows us to give the machines mission-type orders. Hey, screen this named area of interest and tell me when you see person X or vehicle Y, and then report back to me. These systems will conduct their processing autonomously, and so they're really only interfacing with a human, just like a subordinate fire team leader going back to the squad leader when they have something to report or need new orders. You can go ahead and go to the next slide. All that being said, Mr. Kelley mentioned trust already, and I think it's something we can talk a lot about as part of the panel. In my experience, starting to think about these things over the past year, the trust factor has mostly been about how much trust do we withhold. So we talk about the killer robots. Do I give that robot a life or death decision without a person in the loop to make that decision for him somewhere along the way? And where is that point? Do I suffer from the irony of automation and that I've got to constantly monitor the system to be ready to take over, or am I willing to let it operate more freely? And in our doctrine of maneuver warfare, trust is absolutely essential. So for Marine leaders who interact with these things, they're going to need to have a basic understanding of the hardware and software that makes up the system and work with it often enough to understand how it's going to respond, just like they would with their manned or with their human teammates. I did want to address, though, the flip side of the coin. And this, some of you have probably seen this. This is a picture of a robot that was used in the Georgia Tech experiment. And what this experiment proved was that you can take people and have them follow a robot to a meeting, have that robot demonstrate incompetence, make wrong turns, break down, et cetera. And then when you put the people under pressure, like a simulated fire, they will still follow that robot past clearly marked exit signs, down darkened hallways filled with furniture, because it's a robot and must know better. And I think there's risk on that side as well, especially as we're early in automation, that we assume it's a machine, it's perfect. And so we have to ensure we continue to teach our leaders at all levels critical thought, because you have cyber threats, you have RF interference, you have just general wear and tear on these systems out in an expeditionary environment, which could impact the quality of the information coming back. And so that information should be evaluated by the leaders in the same manner that they would if it was coming from an unmanned system. Sir, that's all I have. I look forward to your questions.
Okay, and Jinx, just one thing. The work that that you guys have been doing down at the Warfighting Lab and the number of events that you guys have been holding lately have been spectacular. So hopefully a little bit later on, maybe you could talk a little bit more about that. But I tell you, as a former Marine, I'm really, really impressed with what's gone down. And I know that General Alford probably doesn't really care that I'm impressed with what he's doing down there, but I think you guys should be extraordinarily proud of you guys are leading the way, to be perfectly honest. So
thank you, sir.
Thanks a lot.
You know, it's a bunch of captains and majors doing all
yeah,
the
I
work.
Yeah, I do know. I do know that. That's why, and good on you for not taking credit for it, by the way. Okay, good to go. Admiral Nadeau, sir, so, you know, what we're already starting to build a trend on here, and that is there's obviously some technical challenges, and with your engineering background, I'm sure that those might even seem to you to be like the easier ones. Look forward to your remarks, sir.
Sir, you give me more credit than I deserve. I was not a very good student, low grade C, so the reason I'm no longer an engineer now they promoted me is to get me out of that work.
Well, you know what? That would have been nice to know before we picked you for
yes, sir.
Okay, so.
No money back guarantees. Thank you very much to Sea Air and Space Navy League for hosting this great event, and thank you, sir, for inviting me to participate in this esteemed panel. Yeah, we don't have an Office of Unmanned Systems in the Coast Guard yet, so this is what you get. But I will go through quickly and just touch on some things where we are taking advantage of machines and have our people working with them and taking advantage of what that provides us. You know, you look on the left there, that's how we used to do life-saving back in the day. You have people in huts sitting along the beach, maybe walk along the beach, and their ability to detect people in distress was limited by how far they could see and what they could hear. And then if they did hear something, they went and pulled the boat out of the shed there and or tried to row out and find them and save the people. We had great success doing that. We saved many, many lives. But here's how we do it today. On the right, we have a command center manned 24/7. All kinds of sensor data come into that command center. And they can actually take the search out of search and rescue. We have equipment lining 40,000 miles of coastline that can help detect when someone actually triggers their radio. We can find them with lines of bearing, DF in, and then launch our RBM there, our response boat medium, which cruises out about 40 knots and can help them if they're in distress. So we have made some progress. Next slide, please. On the counter drug side, there you see up in the upper left, that's how they used to do it, right? We sail our boats out to the entrance to the port and look for bad guys coming, trying to smuggle things into port, and we'd hail them and hopefully they'd stop and we'd go over and do an inspection. Then as things progressed on the lower left, that's when I got involved. We would go out on these ships. We still have those in service, actually, since the mid-60s. We would go out and patrol in a box. They give us some coordinates out there in the middle of the ocean, and you patrol in your box looking for things. You climb up on the flying bridge. You look through the big eyes, which I'm sure a lot of you have done. You look for stuff. You see somebody out there. You hop in your motor surf boat and cruise over at 6 knots. Hopefully they stop for you. Maybe they don't. And then you climb aboard and see what you find. Today, on the right, you see our national security cutter has all kinds of capabilities there, using lots of different streams of intel. Cruises out, we have two different small boats on board that we can use, each depending on what the situation may warrant. They cruise out at 60 knots. The bad guy doesn't want to stop yet. We now launch the helo that they carry, which has a gunner in the back and is authorized to take warning shots and then disabling fire to shoot out the engines so we can get them. So we're used to get, you know, bringing a few pounds of marijuana, come back a few pounds of weed if you were lucky. Today, I can say that the Stratton came back last year after a four-month patrol, worked with a few others, with 33 tons of cocaine, pure cocaine on deck from one patrol. So we are taking advantage of some of these technologies and having an impact. Next slide, please. Aviation, I won't spend a lot of time. I'm sure we've got a lot of aviators in the room know more about these aircraft than I do. But suffice to say, they've come a long way from when we had our hover boat up there on the left to our C-130J and our Minotaur system and just freeing up the aviator's time on board to be able to do other more important things than just staring at the screen. Next slide, please. So when I think about this problem set, there's a couple things I've observed, which I know more esteemed panels probably add to this. But one thing I think is that can't lose sight of the fact that it's not just purely the engineering and the scientists that comes up with some of these ideas. It's really, an intersection of the arts and the sciences with the engineering, or the arts and the humanities with the sciences and engineering. You look at Leonardo da Vinci coming up with this helicopter concept 450 years before it was developed. Einstein, when he was trying to work on general theory, if he hit a hard spot, he'd whip out his violin and start playing Mozart. So there's this certain creativity that comes from these people that are extremely genius, but they also have a soft side, if you will. Second, I would point out that with the Industrial Revolution and how man took advantage of machines there, I think some of that still stands true today in a couple things. We look at what we need to do and we break it into discrete tasks. And then we take a look at those tasks and see which of those we can use machines to help us. I don't think that's changed today when I look around and I see that that's still, that model holds true today. It's just, do we use a machine to perhaps replace the human in that task, or are they simply enhancing the effectiveness of the human in doing those tasks? In the lower left, I just would want to make a point that we're not the only ones that are using machines. The adversary is also very keen on this. That is a picture, it's a very crude machine, but a very effective one. That's a self-propelled semi-submersible, which some of the transnational crime organizations can pack with about 6 to 8 tons of cocaine, and they make it very hard for us to detect. And lastly, I think this evolution does take time. And as we do that, I want to say that it's my belief that it's very unusual to have some genius sitting in the corner that has a sudden brainstorming session by himself that comes up with a great idea. It's more often a team of folks, academia, private industry, government, military, all working together, which then weave this tapestry, if you will, of this creativity that really brings us to new and exciting places. And lastly, I'd say that General Kelley touched on, the trust factor for me is something that I just look at my kids and, you know, I give them any new thing I buy in the store, you know, iPhone or whatever. I come home and I'm looking for the manual. The first thing I do is I go, I got to look at the manual, figure out how to use this thing. Whereas I look at my kids, I just hand it to them and they immediately know how to use that. And to me, that gets back to the trust. But how comfortable am I with these new machines and this ability versus what my kids and their kids might be able to do? The limiting factor may not be our ability to come up with the machine. The limiting factor may be our ability to accept its use, which I think we touched on. That's all I have for you. I look forward to your questions and the other discussion. Thank you very much, sir.
Thanks, and a great point. You know, so here we are, you know, some older folks sitting up on the panel for you, and twice or maybe even three times we've talked about trust. And one thing maybe that we'll be able to talk on later on is, as we, at least within the Department of the Navy, go out and canvas our civilians and our sailors and you know, our Marines, in terms of, you know, what are they thinking about with unmanned systems, we get a couple of different groups that break out there. And in some ways it's surprising, in some ways that it's not. But I will tell you one thing, it's our younger Marines and sailors and our younger civilians that come in as engineers to work in our warfare centers are appalled when they don't find it. They expect to come in to a Navy, a Marine Corps, and the Coast Guard and see it. In many ways, that's why some of them joined, because they felt that that we would be on the leading edge here. And so in many ways, it's our younger folks that are driving that, and so that might be something we can explore a little bit later on as well. So General Coglianese, as we said before, is the Assistant Deputy Commandant in INL, working in LP. Is that correct, sir? Roger that. Now, he too will probably tell you that he's got a bunch of young young Marines and civilians that that are really pushing the envelope as well in the LP. And I would say that it's one thing that I'd like to remark on, and that is a lot of this is not going to happen without leadership. I do know that within INL, General Dana has been pushing a lot. General Dana picks his team, so he picks General Coglianese out there to lead LP, which I think is really, really important. And the other thing that I think that they've done in INL as well is sort of push the notion that you don't have to be within a domain. That's not your domain of expertise in order to push where we go with unmanned systems. So, sir, over to you.
Yeah, Frank, thanks. Frank was referring to our class in 1983. We were in the same TBS class at Quantico, and Frank was a lot smarter and a lot better shape than I was back then. So we had a very good class. Four of us made general officers out of that class, so I was the surprise candidate.
You're still here, sir.
Yeah.
I don't know about that.
So what I want to do is, we like framing things and putting points of reference. Right, my boss, he talked about, Kelley talked about General Dana. General Dana, his words, he's liquored up on innovation every day. And so is our commandant. And so both deep thinkers and both wanting to push where everybody's uncomfortable. And so we're partnering within INL, within where General Dana's in charge of installation logistics, really the G4 for the Marine Corps. We formed a team, and the team is headed up by Colonel Springer and some great civilians and Marines. But that's kind of their night job. You know, it's not, they're doing other things. But the truth is, if you read General McChrystal's book, Team of Teams, that's what we're doing, working with the War Lab, working with all the other services and everything that's happening. And so many things are happening, trying to fuse that and come together as opposed to working against each other is kind of what General Dana's doing with this logistics innovation team. So in 2013, Mr. Wheeler, from the Federal Director of Federal Communications, pretty much framed the revolution in networks in from printing press, telegraph, railroad, and digital network. And that digital network is kind of what we're living in now, and I would say that Steve Case, who wrote a book, kind of the founder of AOL, and wrote a book, Third Wave, he further breaks down the digital network, and he said the digital network was, if you think about it, in 1972 when the first email was sent, and people were excited about that, I guess, or those who knew about it, and it was sent over the networking system, which we call the internet. And so the first part of the internet was really building the infrastructure. You know, that's the Cisco's, the Sprint's, the system itself, how we were going to communicate over it. And then the second part of it, Steve Case says, really was the software development, the iPhones, the iPads, the applications that are out there. And that's kind of what we're, I would say, coming out of now. And then the third phase is really the Internet of Things, that, you know, we're now, everything is connected, and that's those sensors that are being developed that every day you can't go by, either television commercial or a radio commercial or something, of some other sensor that you can use in your home or at work that is really some dealing with artificial intelligence and making decisions for you, whether it's the temperature in your house or security type of things. And that's kind of where we are now, and that's moving really fast, I would say. Slide. So in it, when we're talking about the topic, the human interface with machines, you know, so we always interface with machines. You know, you look at the Model T, we had to crank, you know, hand crank it to get it going back then. And now we have systems on cars that park themselves with the human in the vehicle. once the human pushes the button. And then we have, you know, which is out there now, the autonomous type of systems that are driving themselves, that are making decisions. We have aviation technology that we're experimenting right now with flying helicopters that literally will fly the helicopter and make decisions, dealing with the weather, landing zone, winds, and all that kind of stuff. Autonomous cars are here. I think the technology in this area is biggest explosion is going to be both in medical and education. I think it's going to turn the world upside down on that. You know, I sit here right now, my wife's a juvenile diabetic since 12, and she's legally blind. And I'm sitting here monitoring her blood sugar right now. You know, and so that that she has an insulin pump, and she has to manually turn it on, but pretty much that's going to be done once FDA okays it. She's going to have, you know, a pancreas replacement, basically. And you think about when you Google medical right now, when you're sick, right? We get on, we figure out what's wrong. We tell the doctors oftentimes, hey, I Googled it, and this is what I think I have, right? And sometimes we surprise them in that. And that trust, when we have that, you imagine that computer or that software is going to tell us what's wrong with us. Very predictive, you know, high blood pressure or whatever, you're coming down with this. So I really think that's going to be, and that's coming really, really fast. I think there's a, if you look at this is where we're going, we have an MTVR, 7-ton in the Marine Corps, and you talk about autonomous vehicles, you know, will we be driving MTVRs in the future? Probably not. Probably we'll be programming the vehicles. Or the vehicles actually would be at the sensor suite. We'll tell it to go do something, and it'll figure out how to do it. If you look at the comm suite there on the side, we have humans, you know, actually monitoring and looking at data and trying to make decisions on that. And if you ever worked in a command center, there's no such thing as one single operations picture. You have, as we get more sensors and all, you usually have more and more things come in. It's kind of the art of command, if you will, having this information coming in and trying to make a decision on it. With artificial intelligence and everything else, a lot of that stuff will be consolidated and basically come up with probably with choices for commanders. This is what's happening, and you can make these three choices to affect these outcomes with the information that's coming in. And hopefully it won't be a single outcome. It'll give the commander, and we'll talk about that kind of reason why we don't want to turn everything over to a machine, that we need that human interface. And then if you look at the next one, the fixed displays, and you talk about augmented reality and battle space. You know, I would say we're there now, too. We have, in the Marine Corps, infantry immersion trainer, where we put Marines in. They have... It's a real environment, but it smells, sounds, it replicates the battle, things they're going to see, because your sensors are the most important thing in time of war, the human sensors I'm talking about. But they're able to train in an environment that they're going to and simulate that, and that's kind of, with the technology, it's amazing what we can replicate. If you think of the advanced simulators now and everything else, you can be anywhere in the world. Now, you talk on the logistics, you know, whether it's Desert Storm or any of the recent conflicts, it's amazing how dependent we are on fuel, ammunition, and food, and the size that we as U.S., just the volume, I would say, that we require with a large force. You don't see that, but the number of ships, number of trucks, refuelers, and everything else, it's daunting. And if you kind of look at, in the past, if, whether it's the Battle of the Bulge, or you pick the military, you know, Napoleon, or you pick anything how the adversary lost, or whoever lost, oftentimes it was a logistics failure that they couldn't keep up with their logistics. And so we can't have those mountains anymore. We have to be smarter in it. And so you kind of see the Amazon, you know, drone type of thing. And that's what we need, whether it's a drone or a vehicle or submersible, or we have to be smarter and more flexible. And also we need volume to do it, depending what area. We need cheap things to do it. Not as logistics, we don't want to have this multi-million dollar UAS system delivering a pallet of MREs. We want to have that UAS system that if it gets shot down, we don't care, in the sense that we have so many of them that we can, you know, mass them, send them, and they're somewhat expendable. You talk about, say, some of the concerns is when you have the machines doing everything, you lose some expertise. If you think about your children right now, voice to text and stuff like that, I don't know if anybody can write. And as it gets more sophisticated, you know, the machines are actually doing things for you that we used to do ourselves. So you lose somewhat of an expertise. Also providing solutions. If the machine provides, I said three examples of a course of action. If you ever think about it now, you go on Google Maps, and you really don't question it. You just say, go there. And if you ask how you got there, you have no idea because you just went by Google Maps. And the machine made the decision for you. And so there's a concern that if we'll take the human brain's pretty powerful, and if you take it totally out of the decision cycle, you might be making the wrong decisions. But and then just the loss of, believe it or not, the social interaction and the loss of adaptability. You got to be an adaptive thinker. If you stop thinking and let the machine do all the thinking, once again, you're going to be controlled by that machine, if you will, in its decision. We need to use it, but we need to keep the human brain a part of the solution. And slide. That's it. Right? Yeah. I look forward to your questions, and thanks again, Frank, for the invite.
Miguel, thanks. You just reminded, first of all, I think there was a story on NPR this morning about truck drivers that can now, as they get tired, just crawl in the back of their cab, and the truck will continue to drive. So think about that the next time you're on I-95, okay? But the other thing that I think that you brought up, sir, that's a really good point, and that we need to incorporate this into our lexicon of domains for unmanned systems, and that's the IT realm. General Coglianese, one of his jobs is in the basement of the Pentagon, literally watching the world. You're the watch officer for the world, right? And our IT systems, our information systems, how we make decisions is critically important, and that's one that we can't forget. And you finished off with thinking. I'm just going to tell you right now, I think that Admiral Girrier probably has a thing or two to say about how we think. So, and he comes by it honestly. So thanks, sir. Go ahead.
Thanks, Frank. So I think as we talk today, this morning, about human-machine teaming, I think context is really important. So just a couple of slides here to help frame the discussion, and I definitely want to get to some questions, certainly. So I'll move through these. So I think context, the path that we're on, as you can see here in the slide, you know, this is there's lots of continuums that you can consider about how you think about the march of time moving through. Here's one of them, how we think about information from analog, digital information, the current age. And one can put forward, are we now entering the collaboration age? And so it's how you interface with machines, with technology, in a more collaborative fashion, hence the name. And the green there, that's why I want you to focus on those two parts. You already heard today, this morning, about trust. And I'd offer, why trust? It keeps on coming up again and again. Well, if you find ourselves, again, context, amidst this tide, this rising tide of technology, and you think about how do we best leverage this in our existing forces, in our profession, security, defense, we're heavily invested in platforms, ships, submarines, aircraft carriers that are spectacularly capable. How do you leverage to greatest effect technology? And it comes down to trust. I didn't think of this phrase, but I love it. I mean, it's the bottom line is that culture eats strategy's lunch, right? You've heard that before. But I want to bring that up because it's about trust and building a culture that says, there's something there that we can leverage. Machines, unmanned systems, and factor them into every aspect of our current profession, of how we do things in the Navy, how we can help out sailors and Marines in our tasks. So that's the purpose of this slide, and also to offer a context of this march of information and what's at our fingertips now. But it's also cautionary in that if we don't trust these things, we'll never implement them or fully employ them, hence not realize the full potential, while others may do so, that are not as heavily invested in things from the 20th century as we move forward. So let's talk next slide here about how we've been using unmanned systems. A very, very simple set of slides here that just talks about initially kind of platform-centric, the first orb there, an extension of what you currently have. You know, and that may be very obvious. In fact, it is obvious. Is that unmanned system help you see over a hill, or is it something that you launch from an existing platform, you control it? So again, along with that, human-assisted, human-controlled. And that's what the state of art of technology at the time. So it was very natural. And you look at that middle piece about, well, maybe there's more we can do. Maybe you can have more of them. Create distribution networks, and you plug into it, cover more area. Because there's lots of job for us to do out there. Lots of spaces to connect, to be aware, to maintain situational awareness. So that's the second role of unmanned systems, you know, a very broad category. And these all haven't necessarily evolved in sequence, I think generally left to right, but you can find examples of all three of those that exist now. And then the third part on the right, this notion of human-machine teaming we talk about, the subject of our panel. You know, and as technology increases the capability of systems, unmanned systems, to have higher levels of autonomy, because autonomy is just that, autonomy comes in degrees, to the point of artificial intelligence, the higher end, they can do more things that are not as directly connected to the human, but the human's still in control, in command. And there's something to that. There's something to be gained, something we need to factor into our force. So this is a way of thinking about it. And each of you, based on your experiences and your backgrounds, can come up with examples of each one of those things. But I'd offer, if we have to deconstruct how we do business, how we think about our job, our profession, our fleet, sailors and Marines doing their jobs, you have to kind of deconstruct it to its most basic level, and then think about how we can add value, trusting these systems. Because if we don't do that, we'll pursue excursions, and will not be as fulsome as it could be. All along, you see those continuums on the bottom. Which leads me to the last point, and that's, what's the main thing? What do we do? And I'll offer the main thing, and this slide shows you, I'll put it together for you, so I hope it isn't too confusing. It's to understand, and then act. You know, Boyd came up with this back in the 40s, right, during World War II, to observe, orient, decide, act, repeat, adapt. Do it better, faster than your adversary. It was crafted in a fighter cockpit mentality, if you will, for how an individual, a fighter, understood his environment, observing and orienting, making decisions and then acting, and doing so quicker than their opponent, their adversary. So in this construct here, you've got input and output. Input on the top, the green, and on the bottom, the orange there, the output, the effects, sensors, effectors, we say. And what's that part in the middle? That's that orient and decide piece. That's the human-machine piece. But I'd offer human-machine teaming can take place all across those. So the arrows, the gray arrows on the left and right side, it takes place in all domains. You know, as Frank had mentioned in his opening comments, about we shouldn't be so domain-centric. Yes, things take place in domains, of course they do, but that's not the main thing. And warfighting and security takes place on various platforms and ships, submarines, aircraft carriers, vehicles, on land, expeditionary forces. You know, those are things, that's the with what. But increasingly, it's more about the how and how fast, and not so much the where, the domain, and the with what. Of course you have those things. But your ability to traverse what you're seeing, understanding, figuring it out, doing it quicker, deciding to act, to the point of forecasting. Now that's human-machine teaming. That's fighting at machine speed, if you will. That's that combination. It's not all machine, it's not all human. It's that thing we sense intuitively, that you put them together the right way, and our view clearly is keeping the human in command, but increasingly leveraging what the machines can do for you, what machines do very well in deterministic situations, and then leveraging creativity, wisdom, if you will, that humans have. And together, that's a pretty powerful combination. So that's what we think about when we talk about human-machine teaming, and then the need to deconstruct how we fight, how we orient, and then see the applications for unmanned systems throughout.
Sir, thanks. I'll tell you one thing. You know, when you get a chance to start a new organization, you know, it can be hard. It's really good when leadership sets up two organizations, because then you can form a bond early, and at least you have somebody to kind of commiserate with. And sir, I want to thank you. There's not much commiseration because we're just, quite frankly, too busy. But it's been an honor. I think I have said it, and I think others have said it, though. It's with working with Admiral Girrier is both inspirational and aspirational. He really compels us to think harder, think longer, think in the future. So sort of thank you. And Dr. Singer, one of the things I neglected to mention is that you have degrees from both Harvard and Princeton. Is that correct? I hope it is. Thank you. Okay, you do now have those degrees, but thank you very much. But I'll tell you one thing that I really appreciate, and that is without ever knowing any of that, your ability to seamlessly fit in with a room full of JOs or a room full of SESs, admirals, generals, captains, PFCs is remarkable. And there's a reason why you're the only civilian on this panel, sir, and we look forward to hearing from you. So thank you very much.
Thank you. It's an incredible honor to be up on the stage with these leaders, but it's a double honor. One of the things you didn't mention in my bio is my grandfather was a Navy captain who served in World War II and Korea, and some of my most cherished memories are going to visit my grandparents and in his study leafing through Sea Power magazine and the like. So this is just a real special to me to be here. There's so many exciting programs that we've heard about on stage, or you could go downstairs and see on the convention floor, that I thought the most valuable way for me as the civilian outsider to aid the conversation is to lay out a few of the key challenges that we face in the years ahead. And since, actually, if you can, you're already flipping ahead for some reason. If you can go back to the slide that we were on. Go back, please. Since we were limited to three slides, and as you've seen, there's three there. So I'm gonna identify three of the challenges. You'll note, though, and this relates to the theme that we've heard across the conversation, is that none of these three challenges is about the technology itself. It's about the human side, and not the human individual team member, but rather the human organizations and ideas that I believe could prove most vexing. So now, let's jump ahead to the next slide there. Okay, the first challenge is what I would call the old and new problem. More directly, what I jokingly call the Pontiac Aztec of war phenomena. So when it comes to talking about defense systems, we focus on weapons programs that start out promising all sorts of things, but they end up being overpriced, over-engineered, and over-promised. A lot like how the Pontiac Aztec was supposed to be everything from a sports car to a minivan to it would take you camping and the like. Now notice I did not name any defense systems, but many of you are thinking in your head about certain parallel programs. My point though is when you go to this bottom graph there, it lays out the top 10 Pentagon programs of record by what we're spending now, but you'll notice a couple things that stand out about it. The first is, even though that's what we're spending the most on right now, we still have a massive amount of spending to come on these top 10 programs of record. The second thing that you'll notice is that there is no use in that program. That is, one side of the team is missing from what we're spending the most on. Now, the issue isn't that in the years ahead we won't be spending more on unmanned systems, but in some way, shape, or form, they are competitive with existing programs and systems. And so as the Pentagon wrestles with, you know, a flat budget environment, the new becomes directly threatening to the old. And in bureaucracies, the old is often at an advantage. It's more likely to have internal constituencies, be they program offices or cultural tribes, officers who identify with that system. They also tend to have stronger support from members of Congress who want to protect existing factories and existing jobs in their districts rather than the promise of some future program office. Next slide. The second problem is what I call the seaplane problem. There's very few that are outright resistant to a new technology or tool, but we often fool ourselves. We like to say that we are embracing the new, but tend to do so only in a way that supports and sustains the old. It's akin to if we were gathering at a Navy League convention, say in the 1920s, and you would likely have heard from battleship captains who would say, no, I'm not against planes. In fact, I've taken very valuable deck space on my battleship and apportioned it to seaplanes. I'm embracing the aviation revolution. What I'm getting at here is when we're thinking about the new, or when we're thinking about machine-human teaming, how does it break the existing approach? And if it doesn't break the existing approach in at least seven ways, and what we buy, how it changes the way we train, how it affects personnel system, including promotions, what doctrine we choose, what tactics we use, to how we overall organize bureaucratically. If it doesn't change these, either individually or more importantly, all seven of them, then is it just like what happened in terms of putting a seaplane on a battleship? Third challenge, next slide. Synergy. There's so many different amazing programs going on, and again, you've seen them downstairs to in the book Ghost Fleet, which is available on paperback for $11 next week. Please tweet about it. We document at least 21 different examples of man-machine teaming autonomous weapons programs that we're working on today. And there's, of course, many more than that. But we document them, and they take place in all the different domains, as you laid out, of conflict, be it undersea warfare, aerial, to new domains like cyberspace, outer space. The key is that each of these is a historic level shift within that domain, but the fact that they're happening simultaneously makes it all the more demanding. And so to me, the doctrinal question is not merely are we working enough on each and what should we be doing, but how do we bring them together? Not just how do we bring human and machine together, but how do we bring cross-domain teaming together? My sense is whoever gets that right will be the winner or loser in terms of the next major conflict. Right now, we're wrestling with finding the equivalent of, say, the Blitzkrieg, or the fleet problem exercises, or the Marines wrestling with amphibious warfare and close air support and the banana wars in Latin America in the 1920s and 30s. And I think it's important to end on those parallels that I gave. They point to how neither budget nor operational pace are limiters from learning, innovation, and adapting. They figured it out in the 1920s and 30s. We can figure it out today. Thank you.
Great. Sir, thanks very much. Now, we have microphones in the middle of the room, and I'll tell you what we're going to do is we're going to establish a priority of questions. If there's folks that have questions in the room and you'd like to go to the mic, I'm going to take that one first. I see folks getting up, but they're heading in the wrong direction. Okay, that's not a good sign. You're a good man. Hold your, okay. We also have the app, okay. And we've got some good questions already from the app. And I really encourage you to ask your questions. So it looks like we've got some folks queuing up over here to my left. And go ahead, sir.
Question about the culture that's been raised a lot. Admiral, you said that culture eats strategy's lunch every day. And I've noticed that our culture, for some of the reasons that some of our panelists have brought up, is very platform-centric. I want my destroyer or my aircraft carrier or whatever to be the fighting knight in shining armor that it is. So our culture and our military culture of we are warriors, well, you all are warriors, I'm just an engineer. But you know, we are warriors and we're gonna do the fair thing and we wanna make sure that we minimize civilian casualties and all of that. All of these things kind of push us to a particular area of unmanned weapons. And then on the other hand, we have adversaries who, if you look at their culture and their doctrine, it's all about asymmetric warfare and having the land rise up and be the enemy of the invader. And these sorts of kind of classic Maoist sorts of doctrines. So their culture is very much, I want these unmanned systems because they pull into my culture, my doctrine, my strategy. So how do we kind of bridge that mismatch that we have going on?
So, great question. Thank you very much. I that was job number one. When we first stood up N99, again, as Director of Unmanned Warfare Systems for the Navy, it became very clear to me that my relevance, our relevance, the office's relevance, getting unmanned spread in the Navy, the Department of the Navy, Navy Marine Corps team, both, wasn't about me being a cheerleader and asserting it with a loud voice. It was all about bringing along all the other tribes as well. And so job one was to make the point that there's something that's bigger than all of us. And if you had to deconstruct it again, hence the point of my first couple of slides, you had to say, well, what does a winning team look like? You know, and if you can see farther, understand quicker, act faster, and adapt continuously, those four things, that's a pretty darn good warfighting winning team. And those things cut across domains, they cut across platforms, they cut across communities. And that was job number one. Because you're right, I couldn't agree with you more. If you're completely obsessed, you know, and it's understandable, you invest in platforms and systems, billions of dollars, and the training associated with mastering those systems. But to what end? In the end, it's a team problem set that we're involved in here. So that was the first job, to get everyone to agree to that. And I'm here to say, and I'm very happy to say, that there was agreement that there's something larger than each of those tribes. And unmanned plays a role in each one of those. So couldn't agree more. To get the most out of this, you have to go beyond what you know and see where it can help. Thanks.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Ma'am?
I have a question for Colonel Jenkins, and maybe Admiral Girrier and others want to get at this too. I wanted to get back to what you said about developing the trust between the troops and their potential unmanned teammates. I was wondering specifically if there are ways of training that you're looking at that could get at that, or new ways of introducing the equipment, or whether it's just a matter of establishing the reliability of the systems and developing that trust over time.
Thanks. So I think I would say, first of all, that there's no better experience than actually putting them in the hands of Marines, and I think that's where you get to Dr. Singer's point, is that we're still fighting those established program office in terms of just providing exposure. I think it emphasizes again what General Coglianese said and what the Commandant said yesterday, is that these things have to be small, smart, and cheap, because I have to be with them every day in some way, shape, or form, and it can't be this boutique item that I roll out once a year and interface with. I've got to be constantly working with it, and so it's got to be disposable to a degree, and inexpensive enough and rugged enough that I can use it on a regular basis. And then I think eventually you'll get to the point where you could do simulation because the software is the brain. Eventually getting that software in support of my maneuver in a simulation environment really allows me to train with the machine as long as I keep the softwares matched up, especially as I start getting into the AI and the machine learning types of things where I need to make sure that all of my systems learn everything that the other systems are learning. So I hope that gets to your question to some degree at least.
I'd like to add if I could, so how do you build that trust? And it's certainly, it's splashing systems, getting them out there in the hands of the Marines and the sailors and to figure out how they work and develop those tactics, techniques, and procedures. You know, part of our portfolio in the N99 office is rapid prototyping and experimentation, working with these systems in an operational context with technologies that are ripe, getting them in the hands. We haven't figured out yet how to use all these things, but building that trust is seeing, a legitimate operational application for it, where, hey, this thing fills a gap, this thing fills a need. It's helping us do something better. And so that builds up trust, especially when it's a solution set for something that's been vexing you for a while. So that's a big part of the trust piece is, again, getting things to fly, getting things to swim, seeing how they work, develop those con-ops.
I think there's an example, you talk about training, there's an example in industry. So you have manufacturing, you go to a plant, and a robot is doing something in a manufacturing line, you also have a human in the line. And some of these companies are actually then, what they're doing is switching tasks. Now the robot does the human task, and the human does the robot task. And it's just that in itself. And if you were using an example of a Marine rifle squad or something like that, and you had a robot doing something with the rifle squad, same kind of analogy, training with that individual, with the robot, with the individuals, and then you'll develop a trust what they can and cannot do. So I think the example of training is a good example. Over.
So, one thing you want to be mindful of in these early introductory exercises, and I'm a huge supporter of them, though, is what Clayton Christensen calls the innovator's dilemma. And it's the fact that the first generation of a technology will invariably be the worst of that technology. And second, usually it's worse than whatever technology it's to replace. And so when you have human organizations that take a long time to adopt, you sort of have to, it's tough for the disconnect between their slowness versus how a technology might go faster. So if you're thinking of the parallel back to the interwar years, if you had limited your envisioning of tanks to, well, the early tanks go slower than people walk, and that's the only way we're going to envision their use versus the assumption that, hey, what happens if they actually can go faster? Or if you're thinking of some early submarines that have little range, you have to be willing to not let the flaws of the prototype steer you away from its long-term possibilities.
And I think if I can build on that, Peter, and you, Admiral Girrier, it's finding that right niche. I mean, we programmatically tend to A, gold plate, and then B, wait till it's perfect, and we've gone through DT and OT before I put it in the hands of Marines. I think what we see over and over again is these young Marines and sailors are better at seeing the potential than some of us old folks are. And so if you can put it in their hands and create a feedback loop that allows them to get back into the discussion, hey, why don't you make it do it this way? Your development and your evolution, if you will, of that system can be a lot greater because of that interface.
Okay, so you three folks that are at that microphone, we are going to get to you, but we've got to use this app. Okay, we've just got to use it. I'm gonna. So what I want the panelists to be thinking about is access. We've got folks in here from industry, from academia, and they're probably going to want to talk to you. I'm going to read it as it was written. Access to the right people within the Department of the Navy and Department of Homeland Security, if I can just throw that in there, can be challenging for many technology firms. How does an innovative organization initiate collaboration with the Navy, and how can they benefit? And Admiral Girrier, can I start with you?
Certainly.
Thanks.
Again, you know, this conference is a good example, a good starting point. We're certainly reaching out. Not a week goes by when I'm meeting with representatives from industry, academia, other government entities as well. This whole notion of how we partner and because the solution set is clearly not held by any one entity. I'd offer our government labs is a very good portal, if you will, or a pass through to interface. I work with a Frank's office on a daily basis. We work with our warfare centers that are developing technologies to meet needs. They reach out to industry continuously. That is a very good avenue. That is an active avenue that are, our warfare centers that are currently engaged in projects and meeting needs. So, again, the dialogue is one area. The warfare centers directly through, I offer those two avenues as rich.
Thanks, sir. Appreciate it. Okay, sir.
Thank you. We've seen a lot of interest in the third offset with undersea warfare. So I was wondering, with the unmanned systems, how are we planning to use them for anti-submarine warfare? Are these going to be just new platforms that we can put sonar sensors and other sensors on and to attack? Or is there a new concept of operations that we can use unmanned systems to conduct anti-submarine warfare?
I'll certainly take that question. I think, you know, right now our approach is broad. It's based on the understanding that even as I talked about in my opening remarks, that there are unmanned systems that we can use that augment an existing platform, that help a platform do its existing job. There are unmanned systems that can serve in distributed netted manners that we can then work with. And then there's a higher end as technology has enabled it, and various technologies support this, especially as we look at energy systems and the density of energy systems becoming greater. You can put more into a smaller package. And so in that area, and also as we develop autonomy, you can think about unmanned systems that are off operating more independently. So in those three categories, you've got different functional approaches. And then I'd offer there's even sizes of how things, small, medium, and large, if you will. So it's very much a broad approach that seeks at meeting gaps. In the end, my hypothesis when it comes to unmanned systems, undersea systems specifically, but all of them, is that if we use them right, we're going to increase our capability and our capacity. It's not unmanned for unmanned sake. It's unmanned where we need it, as an augment to our existing structure. And there's many, many applications for that.
Hi, Mark Palmerlin with Defense Systems. I know you mentioned not to focus on kind of the domain, but that's exactly what I'm gonna do here. The Air Force uses kind of that, or they're developing the Loyal Wingman program for the air domain. I was wondering if any one of you could kind of address some specifics in terms of from a maritime perspective, air, surface, and undersea in ways that this machine teaming can penetrate some of these contested environments.
Can you summarize that? I mean, if I could just summarize, I'll take a quick stab at it. The totality of contested environments, if you will, and the broad application of how unmanned systems can help us work that problem set. Is that a fair characterization of your question?
Sure. Kind of focusing on this sort of A2 AD environment. What are some examples of how this man-machine teaming can help to penetrate those contested environments?
I see. So I think one way is you look at the totality of the problem. Typically, you look at areas that are contested And seldom would I say are all three areas, domains, contested simultaneously. So if you could think about how you look at access in one domain and using it to help unlock another, that is an approach. I'd offer that approach values a system of systems, where you're leveraging, again, going back to Frank's opening comments about it's not all about just the one domain anymore. It's about the general connectedness of many things. So we think a lot about systems of systems. And I can tell you how you think about platforms populating those systems. Manned platforms, unmanned platforms. They can serve as many nodes. So when you start thinking in this larger framework about how you unlock areas that heretofore were contested, it's because I think we were thinking about them in very one-dimensional ways. So that's an approach. Unmanned systems can help populate nodes, manned, unmanned nodes in larger systems of systems.
Maybe I'll add in a couple thoughts on the future of warfare side of this. So when we've been looking at the idea of the challenge of, say, an integrated air defense with particular, the new wrinkle on it is the long range and the ability to strike at our bases. We've been envisioning in the air domain, the unmanned system. We just moved it to the air-to-air refueling side. Basically, you know, we had the situation of short-range tactical air at the very same time an adversary is developing greater reach. So it's, you know, a boxing match where they've got a long punch and we just gave ourselves little alligator arms. And we're exploring the idea of unmanned systems as a workaround to that. Then you had the older idea of the unmanned system as the sensor that it will allow you to detect, in particular, that, you know, the challenge is not just an integrated air defense, it's that it's mobile as well. That's the further wrinkle onto it, so that you can use the unmanned as a sensor to be able to find it. What's interesting to me is the third, and again, that sensor might be something that penetrates the enemy air defense in terms of an exquisite jet fighter-sized program, or it might be a swarm of teeny tiny ones. What's interesting to me is the third category, which is where I believe we will head, which is using the unmanned system and the team to attrit, to destroy that defense. And it might be either it's carrying the weapon systems itself, even the one that's in the air-to-air role. It is going to have to be armed unless you want it to be unable to defend itself and therefore putting the human pilots that depend on it to get back to the carrier at risk. That's why we armed the manned tankers. That's why we will arm the unmanned tankers. But also, so it's not just armed in terms of taking out the enemy. The other thing that unmanned systems offer is their disposability. So it's the envisioning of the way, for example, the Israelis originally used unmanned systems against Syrian air defenses back in the 1980s, where the drone's job was solely to make the air defense to turn on the missiles, the SA-2s, turn on their radars, reveal itself, and even more so, waste missiles shooting at it. We wanted the enemy to shoot down drones. And so we may look at unmanned systems, the part of the team. It may be the disposable part of the team member that you want to get killed. And it's a totally different way of rethinking it. But again, it points to new opportunities and doctrine.
Great, thank you.
Fantastic, thanks. So, and I don't know if Jonathan Leshenko is still here. We had a question from him on the app about weapons release authority, and I think that Dr. Singer's answer responded to that in some way. So Jonathan, hopefully you found that helpful. Now, it looks like a lieutenant commander.
Yes, sir.
Okay, you have been extraordinarily patient. I'm not going to say anything about the gentlemanly manners of the two guys in front of you, but we are going to hear your question, okay?
Thank you. Roger. I'll try and keep it brief. Thank you for being here today. I'm Sarah Rousseau from the U.S. Coast Guard. I have heard each of you talk a little bit about the cultural buy-in from people to trust these unmanned systems or any technology. And I've heard some of you talk about your young children who already buy into it And I can tell you, I'm not even that old, but I have people who work for me who are, they are disappointed in our lack of innovation, our lack of being on the leading edge, and they are doing their own workarounds to complete the same mission that I'm doing. So what they lack, though, is access or understanding of the leadership or the power to change that. So I'm wondering from you, you are the leadership, so what are you doing within your respective service to tap into the ingenuity or the motivation of the young people who are already bought in but don't have access to the power to change that?
So, okay. Yes, sir.
No, I was, so exactly right. So we're doing an innovation challenge for anybody in the Marine Corps. We're going to reward them, come up on the net, and solve. We're going to give them a couple of issues to solve. But yeah, you're absolutely right. It's a very collaborative environment. You know, Steve Jobs said, if you don't cannibalize yourself, somebody else will. And so you're exactly right. And it's not just technology. It's processes and ideas and how to use things better. It's, you know, we as Americans is fixated on technology. So you think about the IEDs. You know, we come up with sophisticated jamming devices, and they come up with fishing wire. And so we do a $1 billion thing, and they do a 10-cent thing to counter our stuff. But those innovation ideas and stuff like that of how to counter that, how to come through it, you're exactly right. And you have to have an environment that accepts it, and also that a culture in the military, we're not necessarily built that way, to have somebody, you know, at PFC come up and go, hey, I have a better idea how to do this. And that you welcome that PFC's idea and then bring it. So we have, I don't want to get into how we're doing it because it would take too much time, but we're doing exactly what you're talking about. Over.
Yeah. I can add, if you'd like, you create the culture, you create the conditions that encourage this information flow. You know, CNO's design, he talks about high-velocity learning, you know, creating a high-velocity learning environment at every level. So what is that? It's a systematic way of applying what you understand, and then you look at it. You come up with a hypothesis. You test it. You measure your results. You come back, and you make an adjustment, and you repeat. And that's at every level. So if you value that from the top, and he has, it's part of his design. It's one of the four main elements of his design. And at every level, we're going back and looking at our own internal processes and saying, hey, what's my hypothesis? How do I think about this problem set? What am I doing? Am I making progress on those areas? Is it what I thought it was going to be? How should I adapt? And again, the scalability of that is every level, from junior to senior. So that's what we're doing now in the Navy right now. And again, it sets up an environment where you're interested in listening.
And Frank, I'd add, we're not doing enough. We could be doing a lot more. And thanks for bringing it up, and keep bringing it up until we do better. Hold us accountable. I applaud you for raising the question. Great question. And I think it extends to many other things as well. I know personally, I just came from boot camp, look at new kids coming in. They're so smart. They're different than when I was at that age, but they're so smart. They bring so much. We have to learn how to tap into that. If we don't, we're going to fail. They're going to go elsewhere. And we don't want them to go elsewhere. We have to keep them in the service. We have to be better at this. No question. Thank you, sir.
Thanks. The other thing I say, without deflecting from us up here, is the lower level leadership needs to do a good risk assessment and then allow that innovation, because you're, at the end of the day, it's hard to change the entire organization all at once, right? When I get the great idea, but if I can demonstrate it and then bring it up the chain, and here's the data that shows how much better this idea is or this piece of gear is. It makes it an easier sell, and as Admiral Girrier said, that hopefully you're working for leadership who encourages that type of exploration and enables you to do that risk assessment to make that happen. But I think that's part of it too, is really at every level. Don't rely on those of us sitting up here to make the changes, but kind of start working to make the change yourself a bite at a time.
Okay, great question.
Thank you.
Thanks very much. And we are over. We are over time, and we are over for this event. But I really appreciate everybody for being here. Yeah. And I also want to thank the Navy League for letting us do this. Obviously, there's an appetite out there for more of this. We look forward to discussing with you in the future. Thanks again.
Thank you. Great comments.
jobs.
I'm working on my strategy. So appreciate it.
We'll talk soon. Thanks. All right. Thank you. Great job. Yeah. Don't fall off the stage.
Yeah. I was going to take a jump. Thanks.
Yes, sir. Appreciate thanks. Good to go.
Hello, Tony.
Yep. Hey.
Thank
great.
You.
Yeah. Thanks, sir. Appreciate it.
Roger
that. Good to go. Hey. Hey. All right. Good to see you.